The likelihood somehow measures the goodness of fit of a model to a sample as a function of the unknown parameters to be estimated. So far, we have implicitly assumed that the sample shared the same statistical properties as the population. But we have seen in the previous video that if we use practical sampling strategies, it yields two samples that do not have that property. And in this video, we will investigate the implications of stratified sampling on maximum likelihood estimation. Until now, we have assumed that X, the explanatory variables, is a fixed vector. So we have written our model as the probability to choose alternative I conditional to the fact that we know X. But when we draw a sample, actually we select individuals who are associated with a specific value of I and specific value of X. So basically we draw both I and X together. Therefore, what we actually need to write is the joint probability of I and X as a function of the unknown parameters. And this can be decomposed as the choice model, the probability of I given X, times the probability of X. And depending on how the sample is drawn, this may impact the estimator itself. What is maximum likelihood estimation? It consists in solving an optimization problem that maximizes the so-called log likelihood function, which is the sum over all individuals in the sample of the logarithm of the probability that both I and X are observed, conditional to the fact that they are in the sample. And to make our notations easier, we define Sn as the event that the individual n is in the sample. The solution of this optimization problem is the maximum likelihood estimator of the unknown parameters. Now we will look at the contribution of each individual in the sample to this function. So we will derive this quantity, the probability that both I and X are observed, given the fact that they are in the sample. And we will use Bayes' theorem to derive this quantity. I will use Bayes' theorem to invert the conditionality of these variables. So I obtain the probability of Sn given In and Xn as a function of theta times the probability of In given Xn as a function of theta times the probability of Xn as a function of theta. Bayes' theorem tells me that this quantity is proportional to the quantity that I have written on the left. So I need to normalize now so that it's actually a probability. And to do that, I sum over all possible values of the explanatory variables, over all possible alternatives in the choice set, and it's the same quantity as I have above. So this is the probability of Sn given J and Z as a function of theta, the probability of J given Z as a function of theta, and the probability of Z given theta. Here, I have simply applied Bayes' theorem to rewrite this formulation. So now let's investigate what are the three terms that appear in the numerator, and actually they also appear in the denominators. So we have this one, and this one. These are the three terms that I was talking about. The first one give me the probability of Sn, so Sn is the fact that individual n is actually in the sample, given that we know I, the choice, and X, the value of the explanatory variables for individual n. And this is what we denoted in the previous video, capital R. So remember, capital R is the probability that an individual with configuration IX, or INXN in this case, belongs to the sample. The second formulation is the probability of the choice given the explanatory variables. But this is exactly the choice model. So we denote it by P. This is our choice model. And for the last one, this is simply the distribution of xn in the population. It's actually not a function of theta. Therefore, we can write it in a more generic way as P of xn. So let's put everything together. So I'm trying to derive the probability of in and xn given sn. This is the contribution of individual n to the log likelihood function. And now I have identified the three components of the numerator and the denominator. So I will use this identification now to write the equation. So the first element is R. The second is the choice model. And the third is the distribution of xn in the population. And at the denominator, we have basically the same. We have the sum over z, the sum over j of r g z theta, p g given z theta, and p of z. This is actually a very complex formulation. And indeed, in practice, in the most general case, this is not possible to handle. But we will see that this can simplify in some specific circumstances. The special case that we will investigate first is the case where our sample has been collected using an exogenous sampling strategy that we have introduced in the previous video. In this case, the probability to be in the sample does not depend on the choice I. It depends only on the explanatory variables x. And what we have seen in the previous video is that in this case, it's also independent from theta. Theta does not play a role in this probability. Okay, so we have here the formulation that we have derived in the previous slide. And we can now simplify it. So I will first replace R I x by R x. Now we can see that this quantity here and this one do not depend on j. Therefore, we can go out of the sum. So the numerator is the same, and for the denominator, we have and now we have a simplification. Indeed, this sum here is equal to 1 by definition of the choice probability. Therefore, the formulation becomes the probability of individual to be in the sample times the choice probability times the probability of xn divided by the sum over z of r z p p z. And now what is important to notice in this expression is that all the elements are independent from theta except the choice model. So there is no theta here, no theta here, and no theta here. And somehow it means that these elements will not play any role in the optimization problem that we will have to solve. Let's look at this. If you remember, the maximization problem we want to solve is the maximization over theta of the sum over all individual in the sample of the log of this probability. And this probability is what we have derived in the previous slide. Now, when we take the log, as we have a product and a quotient of elements, it becomes a sum. So we have the logarithm of r of xn plus the logarithm of the choice model plus the logarithm of the distribution of xn minus the logarithm of the denominator, which is the sum over z of r z p z. But in optimization, any term which does not involve the variables that we optimize, so the theta in this case, do not play any role. The optimal value theta hat of this problem is the same as the optimal value of a problem where we remove all the terms that do not involve theta. But this is interesting because this formulation, the log of the choice model, is exactly what we have used from the very beginning when we started discrete choice. And at that time I told you, well, let's assume that the sample represents the same statistical properties as the population. But now we see that if we perform a stratified sampling strategy and we make sure that it is an exogenous strategy, we obtain the exact same formulation. This is very good news because this standard procedure that we used for simple random sample can be actually used for a case where we can use a practical sampling strategy as soon as it is exogenous. So this is very good news. In this video, we have seen that the general formulation of the maximum likelihood estimation problem is very complex. However, when the sampling strategy is exogenous, it simplifies, and it is actually equivalent to the formulation for the simple random sampling strategy.